Yeah. Right. So the title has been slightly changed. This is a little more accurate, but it certainly involves the L-space conjecture in the background. So yeah, it's great to see everybody. And so I thank Jose, Jennifer, and Mario for the opportunity. Like Cameron mentioned, this is a continuation of his talk and his joint work with him and Ying Hu. And let's see. So throughout M will be a knot manifold. And here we have a clash of conventions because Cameron will call it X, I call it M. And okay, so it shouldn't be too difficult though. So what I mean by a knot manifold is a compact, connected, orientable, irreducible three manifold whose boundary is an incompressible torus. I'm also going to assume that his first Betty number is one. So it's a rational homology solid torus with incompressible boundary. And there are various, Cameron's already mentioned slopes, and there are various ways to consider what a slope is. So it's, well, the original definition, it's an isotopy class of essential simple closed curves on the boundary. And as is known, those can be parameterized by primitive elements of the first homology of the boundary as long as we have an ambiguity of sign. And what's going to be important for us when we talk about LO detection is then it's, you can think of a slope as a line in the first homology of the boundary with real coefficients. That's a copy of R2, which contains a non-zero element of H1 of the boundary. So it's easy to go from the second characterization in terms of primitive elements to the third. And as Cameron mentioned, there's, I'm going to use lambda sub n to denote the longitudinal slope of m. Okay, so that's the represented by a primitive element in H1 of the boundary, which is rationally null homologous in M. Okay, so like in Cameron's talk, we have star will be either NLS for not a null space, LO for left orderable, or CTF for core-oriented dot foliation. And we have the gluing theorem that Cameron gave out the attributions, which says that if you start off with a toroidal manifold W, and you express it as a union of two knot manifolds by some, where we have a gluing map from the boundary of one of them to the other, then W, the union, will have property star as long as F, the gluing map, identifies a star-detected slope on the boundary of M1 with one on M2. So I'm not going to talk at all about the proof of that. It's different techniques, not surprisingly, for each of the three different possible values of star. Okay, so what I'm going to do, though, I will discuss star detection in each of the cases, at least try to give you a flavor of what star detection is of a slope. And then Cameron's already mentioned it, but I'll come back to it, discuss a star detection theorem. So if you want to apply star detection, it's good to know a priori what slopes are guaranteed to be star detected. And that's what our star detection theorem will tell us, at least in certain cases. Then I'll use that, the star detection theorem, together with the star gluing theorem to prove that toroidal integer homology three spheres are LO, and under certain fibrin conditions, they are CTF, of core-oriented top foliations. And then finally, if time permits, I'll discuss our approach to the Gordon-Lidman conjecture on branch covers of satellite, prime satellite knots. And Cameron's already said a few words about it. Now, I don't know if we'll get there, but we'll give it a try. Okay, so what is detection? So we'll start with NLS. And you say a slope is NLS detected if it's contained in the closure. I look at all the slopes such that when I do the Dane filling along one of these slopes, you get something which is not in L space. And I look at, this is a set of slopes, if you like, you can think of it as a set of rational numbers. And it's a subset of the reals. And you look at the closure intersect the rationals. And that's what DNLS is. It's the closure of the set of all slopes for which the associated ding filling is not in L space. So in general, that's bigger than just the set of all slopes, which is not in L space. And as Cameron alluded to, this is actually necessary for what we want to do to take this closure. So say an example, we would take M to be the trefoil exterior. Then it's known that M beta, so that's the beta ding filling of M, is NLS, not in L space, if and only if beta is a rational number from the open interval minus infinity to plus one. So if you take the closure of that in the set of all slopes, you get the closed interval minus infinity one, where minus infinity corresponds to the meridian of the trefoil. And one is the, well, it's just the plus one slope. Now, it's given minus infinity and one are not in this open interval minus infinity to one. So you should get L spaces when you do the ding filling. And in fact, you do. The minus infinity filling is S3. And the one filling is the Poincaré homology three sphere. Okay. So, you know, one question you could ask, why would you call this NLS detection if we're not really looking at things which are giving, not giving L spaces, but to closure? Well, it turns out that, in fact, if you, when you're doing the ding filling, you're gluing on a solid torus, but you should think more generally. We want to glue on knot manifolds, which are what's called a Haggard-Flirt generalized solid torus. So these are knot manifolds such that all the ding fillings except longitudinal ding fillings give L spaces. And it, basic example of such a thing is the twisted eye bundle over the Klein bottle. And it turns out that DNLSM, the set of all NLS detected slopes, is just a set of all slopes for, such that when you I attach the twisted eye bundle over the Klein bottle to M by a homeomorphism which identifies the longitude of N with the slope beta, you get something which is not in L space. So this is what's going on. And like I said, more generally, if I take a knot manifold, which is a Haggard-Flirt generalized solid torus in the same identity would hold. DNLS is just a set of all slopes for which when you attach one of these special type of manifolds, you get something which is not in L space. So that's what DNLS is measuring. I just say parenthetically that there's a notion of strong NLS detection, and that's when the ding filling is not in L space. But we don't. That's not really appropriate for the study of toroidal manifolds and gluing. We want to look at this more general notion of NLS detection, and that's what it is. And if you like it, it is a set of slopes such that when you glue on, say, the twisted eye bundle over the Klein bottle, you get something which is not in L space. So this goes back to a paper of Jake and Sarah Rasmussen, and also, you know, it came up in the paper of Hanselman, Rasmussen, and Watson. Whoops. Okay. So that's NLS detection and what it's some flavor of what it's determining. It's determining whether when you attach N, you get something which is not an L space. What about LO detection? Well, so if I take a, first of all, let's look at left orders on Z plus Z, Z2, and which I think of as a subset of R2. Then given such a left order, you can look at the set of elements that are bigger than zero, and the set of, we'll call those positive, and the set of elements which are less than zero, we'll call that negative. Well, it turns out there's a unique line. For any left order, I can find a line which is in red here, such that everything to one side of it is positive and everything to the other side is negative. So that's uniquely determining the line. So every left order on Z plus Z is giving me a line in the plane. All right. So now let's go for LO detection. Well, if I start with a left order on pi 1m, I can restrict the order to pi, the peripheral subgroup. So I get a left order on pi 1 boundary m, which is Z2. And so then I end up, that left order will give me a line in the peripheral subgroup tensor R, which is just the first homology of the boundary with real coefficients. So starting from a left order, I get this line in H1 of boundary M with real coefficients. And that's just a slope. Okay? It turns out, if you look at this in all generality, this slope could be rational, it could be irrational. Where rational slopes are the sort of classic notion of slopes. But for today, we're just talking about rational slopes. So any left order on pi 1 of m gives me a slope on boundary m. And so a slope is LO detected if it's a the slope associated to some left order on pi 1 m. So that's the notion. But it's not quite the right definition, but I think for our purposes, it's fine. And it certainly gives you the right idea. So a slope beta is LO detected. It's if I can find a left order on pi 1 of m whose restriction to pi 1 boundary determines the line associated to that slope. Okay. So, and then this set of LO detected slopes we call D, well, Cameron noted DLO of m. Okay. Now, a slope is CTF detected. It's a completely different situation. Now we're talking about foliations. So what I want is a corrented taut foliation F on M, which intersects boundary M transversely. So that'll give me a codimension one foliation on the boundary. I don't want there to be rebannuli. I want this foliation to be a suspension foliation. And I want it to have a closed leaf of slope beta. So you're CTF detected if I can find a foliation on M transverse to the boundary of M, such a some leaf on the boundary is just a simple closed curve of slope beta. Okay, so that is the definition of a slope being CTF detected. And we use D sub CTF to be the set of all CTF detected slopes. Okay, so now we've got these three definitions, NLS detection, LO detection, CTF detection. Completely different. And as an example, longitudinal slope is contained in each of these sets. So for instance, NLS, it's NLS detected. That's because in fact, it's strongly NLS detected. If I do the Dane filling of M along lambda M, I get something which is not a rational homology three sphere. So it cannot be an L space. So it's going to be NLS detected. That the longitude is CTF detected, that's a deep theorem of Gabay, going back to Gabay's thesis. What you do is you take a lambda, there's a properly embedded compact connected orientable surface in M whose boundary is a union of like-oriented copies of the longitude. And Gabay says, well, you can find a corrented taut foliation on the manifold where that surface, compact surface, is a leaf. So, of course, then that foliation is also transverse to the boundary and hits the boundary in at least one simple closed curve of slope lambda m. So lambda m is CTF detected. The LO detected, well, I won't go into that, but that's a result of myself with Adam Clay. So what we expect, in fact, now these are, as you see, three extremely different notions, but what we expect is that these sets are equal. The set of NLS detected slopes equals the set of LO detected slopes equals the set of CTF detected slopes. And this you should think of as a relative form of the L space conjecture. The L space conjecture would say that, you know, this closed manifold is NLS if and only if it's LO, if and only if it's CTF. Well, now we're looking at manifolds with boundary, and the relevant relative form would be that these three set of detected slopes are the same. And I think that's one of the importance, one of the things, important factors for the L-space conjecture is that these three quite different concepts, there seems, well, there's an equivalence. So there's some sort of deep structural equivalence going on that we don't see yet, but we certainly, in many examples, there's lots of evidence to support this. Okay, so the detection theorem, well, as I mentioned before, the major difficulty in, we want to show that toroidal manifolds are either LO, CTF, or NLS, and the major, we want to do it using the gluing theorem. We want to show that, you know, we can express it or not as a union of two knot manifolds where a star detected on one side is identified with star detected on the other side. And really what you would like to do is show a priori that certain slopes are star detected to be able to get some good application. So this is the star, at least our star detection, a special case actually of our star detection result is that if I'm gonna add a condition to M, I'm going to assume that the longitude is integrally null homologous. So that means that the longitudinal slope, when I think of it as a simple closed curve, it bounds a, you know, it's it is homologically trivial in M. And what we're saying here is if I look at any slope of distance one from lambda M, now these are, you know, if I represent that by some class, so I think of lambda M as a primitive class, I take another class of distance one, mu, they form a basis for H1 of the boundary. So any such slope, distance one, is star detected as long as, well, star is NLS, star is LO, and the torsion subgroup is of H1 of M is a Z2 vector space, or star is CTF and M fibers over the circle. Okay, so these, of course, what we expect in two and three, we don't need the extra conditions coming after and. But this is just our proofs, our proofs needed. And so that's it, though. We do expect it, that you won't need it. Okay. So when M is an integer homology solid torus, this can be generalized. And I won't state the generalization, but the corollary of the generalization is that, you know, if I take a non-trivial positive L space knot, the slope 2g k minus 1 is LO detected. So this, at least to me, is quite interesting. And oh, and I don't have the picture. Oh, sorry. Darn. That's why I needed my iPad. Okay, so gosh, I hope I have the other pictures. Okay. So the point is for a positive L space knot, all the slopes which are strictly less than 2g minus 1 are not L spaces. So 2g minus 1 is in the closure of a set of, you know, it's NLS detected. But none of the slopes bigger than 2g minus 1, none of them are NLS detected. And what we can show is that, in fact, that this frontier, you know, at the boundary between the set of NLS detected slopes and not NLS detected slopes, that's actually order detected. In fact, in many examples of positive L space knots, we can show that anything bigger than 2g minus 1 is not order detected. So, somewhat interested in that. So, I'm not going to prove the theorem, but I'll just give you some of the elements. Not surprisingly, there are three cases to consider, depending on star. And this, for the NLS part, so anything of distance one from the longitude is NLS detected. Well, this is a basically, it follows from an analysis of the relationship between the Toroidal torsion event and Hagar-Fleur, the Hagar-Fleur homology of its influence. So this is well-developed, it's kind of classical in the Hagar-Fleur world. And in particular, there was a paper, I think it came out around 2017, by Jake and Sarah Rasmussen, who did a very thorough analysis of it. And using the techniques that they developed, that's what we show. Now, oh gosh. Oh, here it is, phew. Okay, so for the LO case, well, Cameron mentioned this. If you have non-trivial representations of pi 1 of m into homeo plus r, you get left orders on pi 1 of m. And so we're going to capitalize on that to prove the LO case of the star detection. And before I show you the diagram, which sort of hand-wavy proves things, let homeo sub z of r be all of the homeomorphisms of the reals that commute with translation by one. This turns out to be the universal covering group of homeo plus S1 in it, a very obvious way. So, okay, how does this go? Well, if I start with M, then I use Gabay's work to get a co-oriented top foliation on M, which is detecting the longitudinal slope of M. And using that, I can, there's a construction, or actually a deep theorem of Thurston, there's a universal circle representation from pi 1 of M into homeo plus S1. And let's just take that as given. So I get representations to homeo plus S1, but that's not really good enough because I want to be in homeo plus R. And that's where we have to use the Z2 vector space. H1 of M is Z2 vector space, because that means the obstruction to lifting row to the universe, well, to homeo ZR. Remember, homeo sub Z of R is the universal covering group of homeo plus S1, and there's a lifting problem. And well, the obstruction vanishes, it turns out, if for lifting it under this condition on the torsion subgroup of H1 of M. Okay, so now I can use the universal circle representation and its lift. It has infinitely many different lifts. Use it, the lifts to construct left orders on M, and these left orders are going to detect slopes. Well, we want to show that they you can detect all slopes at distance one. Well, you have to do a little more work. So you have to show, you have to sort of dig into the dynamics of the action of the universal circle representation to show that rho of pi 1 boundary m has a fixed point on S1. That's necessary. And then, so that's actually is, you know, you get in there and start digging around with the construction. It's non-trivial. More formal aspects of the universal circle representation show you this is the translation number of the lift rho tilde of lambda m. You want to show that's non-zero. And you see every element of homeo sub z of r has a translation number, and which is the average amount a point is moved in the reals by, well, in this case, rho tilde of lambda m. And you need to show that this is non-zero. In fact, we show it's two times the genus of m minus one. But that follows from rather formal properties. Okay. If m fibers over the circle, sorry, so that's, those are the elements which go into the LO case of star detection. For the CTF case, what we do is we, you know, we're going, early work of Rachel, you know, studying foliations in fibered manifolds. And, you know, she starts off by constructing certain horizontal branch surfaces associated to the fiber region. We start the same, and then we want to do this so that the boundary train track of the branch surface carries the slopes we want to detect. Once you do that, then you apply methods of tau Lee to show that you can build a foliation on M, which detects all the slopes of distance one from the longitude. So this is, I would say, sort of, just very basic work, you know, of the sort of the foundational work of Rachel and Tao Li on constructing foliations from branch surfaces and how they relate to what's going on the boundary. Okay, so let's see, how much do I have? 5 minutes left? How much time do I have left? How much?
Yeah,
5 minutes. 5 minutes.
5 minutes. Okay. Yeah. So maybe I'll go on now. Toroidal manifolds for small order first homology. So Cameron mentioned this is the Haygard-Fleur Poincaré conjecture, and it the only irreducible integer homology three spheres, which are L spaces, are S3 and sigma 2, 3, 5. And as Cameron mentioned, this is completely open, but in the toroidal case, about 8 years ago or so, I think, Etikeri proved it, and then it was reproved by Hanselman, and Rasmussen, Watson afterwards. And so as Cameron mentioned, we expect by the L space conjecture that these, you know, toroidal integer homology three spheres are LO. And we also expect their CTF, but we can prove the LO, we can't prove the CTF yet, but we can show that if W contains a fibered knot manifold with incompressible boundary, then it's true. And the proof, it's really a very simple application of both the detection and the gluing theorems. So you'll see. So we start with an irreducible integer homology three sphere. And let T be an essential torus in it. Then I can split W into the union, Cameron mentioned this, of two irreducible integer homology solid tori. So two knot manifolds. Now let's look at in M1. The longitude of M1 is LO detected. Well, I mentioned that it's detected in each sense, but in particular, it's LO detected. On the other hand, the fact that the first homology of W is trivial, it has one element. This forces the intersection between the the longitude of M1 and the longitude of M2 to be one. I mean, in general, the order of the first homology of a union of two M1 and M2 like this is a, this distance, this intersection number divides that. And since it's one, it has to be one. Okay. Well, that means that theorem one, that's the detection, the LO detection theorem. Well, first of all, lambda M1 is distance one from lambda M2. M2, its first homology, the torsion in it is trivial. So in particular, it's a Z2 vector space. That means that by theorem one, the detection result, lambda M1 is LO detected in M2. So lambda M1 is LO detected in M1, LO detected in M2. So the gluing theorem then says that W is LO. So it's as simple as that. And you know, you could do the NLS case as well, exactly the same way. And that goes back to Hanselman, Rasmussen, and Watson. And similarly, if M2 fibers over the circle, you just go through the same argument and you see that W has a core-oriented top foliation. So like I said, given the star detection and the star gluing theorems, deducing theorem two is just formal. What happened to theorem two? Yeah, here it is. It's just a formality. Now I have very little time, so I think I won't talk about the Gordon-Lidman conjecture, but I will talk a little more about toroidal manifolds with small order first homology. So in fact, this argument I gave can be generalized a little bit. If we take a closed connected orientable irreducible toroidal three manifold with small order first homology, no more than four, then the fundamental group is LO. And it has a coordinate top foliation if there's any central torus which splits it into two fibered knot manifolds. There's an interesting corollary of this, at least to me, is that if you take W as in the theorem three, and suppose it has a non-left orderable fundamental group, well, then it can't have a torus, an essential torus in it. So it's atoroidal. And hence it has to be geometric. Okay. And finally, I'll finish with this, that there are exactly four irreducible toroidal L spaces W with H1 W having order five. That's Hanselman, Rasmussen, and Watson prove that there are exactly four, and that each of them are union of two trefoil exteriors. And they have non-left orderable fundamental groups, and they're union of two fiber manifolds. So the theorem three is completely sharp in that sense. You can't do any better. Each of the conclusions is contradicted in this example. Okay, so I'll stop there.
Many, many thanks for your very nice talk. Stephen?
Yeah.
Any question from the audience? Okay, so, well, thank you again. And let's come back in 10 minutes. We